Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Lady by K.V. Johansen, narrated by Heather Costa. Part 1. Chapter 1. The man had been like an older brother to him ever since his parents had got him hired into the caravan mistress Gagusha's gang, but sometimes Zavel could hate the self-righteous bastard of a West Grasslander. Like now. All he had wanted was the loan of a few coins, but no, he got a tongue-lashing instead, as if Hola Sayan had never had a drink or two more than sat well the next morning, or gone with an easy woman. And if that wasn't what he was up to now, skulking down the street with his eyes running anxiously to those two slim figures who'd walked ahead and were now waiting arm in arm, a Grasslander caravaneer with the long braids of the road and another with her Nabani black hair cut short as a Marakander boy's. That one looked around, wondering where her victim had got to. Zavel had Hola Sayan by the arm, stopping the man just walking off on him, and now he dug in his fingers, gaped wordless a moment. Couldn't be. And Hola had been right with them, a hand under the Nabani's elbow, all friendly, when Zavel had spotted the threesome, the West Grasslander and the two women, one of whom was Ivah. The past year hadn't treated her well. She was gaunt and pallid, but cutting her long hair was no disguise at all. He knew the sly, narrow eyes, yellow-brown as his own, the delicate features and tight little mouth, bruised black as it was. She knew him, too. He saw her eyes widen in shock, and damn if she didn't look to Hola Sayan in some appeal.
Hola!
He let go Hola Sayan's arm, pushed away from him.
Ivah! You murdering bastard whore of the Lake Lord, you—
His knife was in his hand, and he leapt for her, reaching to grab her by the front of her coat, to jerk her close and into the stabbing blade. But he choked, jerked backwards himself by the hood of his coat. Hola. Damn him. And he spun around, slashing. Hola Sayan knocked his arm aside, and a fist hit his jaw. He heard the thud of it, felt the jarring clack of his teeth. Then nothing. Sense returned in retching, in white lights smearing and streaking his eyes. Zavel hunched up and groaned, realized the man bending over him, groping in his pockets, was probably not trying to be helpful, and hit him, hard, low, and everything he deserved. The sneaking Marakander thief. He found his knife and staggered away, leaving the man groaning and retching in turn behind him. No sign of Hola Sayan or the women. Sarah curse him. Hola, sneaking off with Ivah, of all people. Of all the girls he could go chasing when he tired of the boss's temper. He was whoring around with the damned dead Lake Lore's thrice damned and treacherous, murdering pet wizard. The woman who'd cut Bakim's throat for him. Or had haughty, I'm too good for a bondman's son Shiva do it for her, to keep her own soft fingers clean. He'd have expected Hola to tear the throat of her as soon as look at her and leave her broken in the street for the real dogs to feast on. Maybe that's what Hola Sayan had been about. Not bloody likely, with that gentle hand under the arm he'd seen when he first glimpsed the man. Subtlety. Sweet talking her off into some private corner where he could kill her tidily out of sight. Wasn't Hola's way. No, at the first sight, first sniff of her, the monster that possessed him should have taken over. The black dog should have been shaking her like a rat, had the throat of her there and then on the street, without ever a thought for what danger that had brought down on the rest of the gang from the Red Masks, the wizard-hunting mute priests of the Lady of Marakand, even if they did hardly ever come out to the suburb. The damned wizard had bespelled Hola Sayan. That explained it. She had bespelled the whole gang, once upon a time, won herself a place with them, got herself made tutor to Pakdala, when they'd all thought her Hola's bastard daughter. Not knowing she was the goddess of Lysavakhel. Not knowing Hola Sayan had been taken and possessed by the black dog. Monster, mountain spirit or not, Hola Sayan hadn't been immune to Ivah's wizardry then. He'd fallen to it again, obviously. And how was Zavel supposed to rescue him? He didn't want to end his life with his neck snapped like a rat's. And Hola, once the dog took him over, was quite mad. Anyway, Zavel had no idea where they'd gone. In bed somewhere, he supposed, and damned if he was going to start checking every inn and tavern to save the fool from himself. Hola would come to his senses in time, surely, It wasn't like Ivah was even very pretty to hold a man for long. Of course, you couldn't call Gagush pretty either, and he'd married her, so maybe that wasn't what Hula went looking for. Zavel's jaw ached. His head ached. He was tired and alone, and he had no money. Hardly any money. A few coins left. He'd already had to pawn his father's saber, the only inheritance he had from either parent, because Gagush refused again to advance him any pay on the next trip. They treated him like a child. At least he had enough for a bite to eat. He didn't think he could chew. His jaw throbbed, and damned if Hola hadn't loosened a few teeth for him. Something to drink, though, would settle his stomach, stop the spinning in his head while he thought what to do about Hola. A drink, and another, because the sweet, thin wine did help, and the luck of the old great gods was with him. He found a Marakander looking to play a game of tables, one of those who came out to the caravansary suburb, thinking the caravaneers all drunken barbarians with the wits of their own camels, and he won the first and third of the three-game match, made a decent purse of the game, and more off the betting, which had mostly been against him, made himself scarce thereafter, because he didn't like the way the loser was eyeing him. He wasn't so drunk as all that. Zavel walked out into a battle. Well, not quite. There had been an unusual number of people rushing in and out of the tavern, so he should have guessed something was afoot. But playing tables meant having your wits about you, and he had shut out the stir and fuss, though it had distracted his opponent to some advantage in that last game. The street, a crooked lane off the main road, was empty but for a couple of running caravaneers. Noise, though, cries and yells, and there was a reek of heavy smoke. He followed the running men, mostly to get himself away from the tavern as quickly as he could, with the pocket of his coat nicely heavy. He had the vague idea of heading for the pawnshop, which was down along closer to the graveyard at the Gore, and an even vaguer notion of seeing what all the noise was, in case Hola was doing something about Ivah at last. But when he rounded the corner onto the main road, it was to a scene of chaos that took him right back to Lysavakhel, where his father had died, where everything changed, and sometimes it seemed he'd lost not only the dead, but the living. The road towards the Gore was obscured by black smoke. Buildings burned, scarlet flames climbing high, the air roaring with them. Screams and cries, the clash and ring of metal, animal roaring too, came from there. Nearer, a smaller battle raged. Women of the suburb and women of the road close engaged with Marakander Temple Guard in red tunics and leather armor, a twisting, tight knot of desperation. He couldn't see who was winning, wasn't such a fool as to rush into it, either way. Fighting street guard never came to any good end, and temple guard, if they hauled you off before the voice of the lady. No, some assassin had murdered her, and the lady, the goddess of the city, spoke for herself now, they said. If they hauled you off before the lady, you'd certainly better hope the old great gods had their hands over you, because nothing short of a miracle would save you then. The caravaneers, outnumbered, broke and surged back. Zavel whirled to run with them. It was that or be taken gawking there by the temple guard pursuit. Sarah, damn him for a fool. He tripped and stumbled along and missed his chance to dart away up the lane again when someone hopefully grabbed his arm to steady him. They didn't run far, just to get their backs against the corner made by a caravansary's outthrust entryway. Its gate was firmly shut. Spears were leveled at the fore, a wounded woman shoved away to the back. Here, she gasped in passing, a black desert woman with tattoos the same red and black as the boss's, but not so thick and heavy. Her lips were going gray. She pushed her bloody slippery spear into Zavel's empty hands before staggering down, trying to bind up the wound in her own thigh with her headscarf. No one spared a hand to help. The temple guard came in a rush. Lysavakhel all over again, in miniature. Zavel chose his man and braced himself. He'd always had a good eye. The spear's point found the weak join he'd marked at the neck, bit, and he thrust and twisted, jerked back. But the damned thing stuck, and the man was a screeching, flailing dead weight, pulling it down, and he lost his grip on the slick shaft. It was all close in work by then anyway, sabers and the stabbing swords of the Marakanders. Not the place for his knife, But he slashed to fend off a Marakander boy, kicked and screamed himself, trying to weave his way back out of it, out of the way of those who had sabers and shields, and some chance of surviving. New yells sweeping from behind. The caravansary doors had opened, and more folk of the road, Marakanders too, rushed out, all armed. They crashed against the temple guard flank, and the guardsmen fell away, running, outnumbered now. Ha! Zavel grabbed up an abandoned short sword and joined the pursuit. A man fell before him, tripped and rolling, and Zavel swung aside to finish him. Flat on his back, the man drew his legs back and kicked him in the gut before he could dodge. He lost his grip on the sword and fell himself, doubled up, nearly lost what little he had in his stomach, gasping for air. And then they were grappling together, kicking and punching, both of them, grabbing for lost swords. The man got him by the braids, dragged him, half rising, and Zavel kicked him down again, jabbed a knee in his belly, found his knife, but the guardsman seized him by the scalp this time and slammed him down against the road. Red fire lanced across sight and his ears roared. Vision blurred. He squirmed sideways. The guardsman's two-foot staff was raised in his hand, teeth grimacing in a blood-masked face. The cudgel came down. Someone was screaming in his dreams, shrill and terrified. His sister, Zavel thought, but he couldn't remember which one. He lurched to hands and knees, squinting at overbright light and gulping against sickness. Not a girl screaming, not one of his little sisters, murdered by the men of Tamgat, the Lake Lord, or taken for bondservants, or who knew what dire fate, but certainly lost, long lost. Not his mother, who had walked into a sandstorm in her despair. No, in his nightmares she never cried out at all, but beckoned, beckoned, and grinned, while the red dust of Sarakalash whipped around her, and her skin dried to leather on her face. He was not dreaming at all. A woman was screaming, her voice rising piercingly over the windstorm roar of other voices. Muzzily, Zavel blinked sense back into his thudding head. He was going to be sick. He had been. His mouth was foul, and he lay in reeking filth, the dust of the road made muck with blood and bile and wine. If he'd fallen on his back, he'd be choked and dead now. He pushed himself to hands and knees, shaking and shivering with cold, and crawled. He'd been lying close up against a wall. He got his back against it and just sat a moment, trying to sort out how bad it was. The screaming drilled into him, and his empty belly roiled as fingers rolled the swollen lump of his jaw, the broken, sticky-crusted egg lump on his head. Far worse. He remembered the guardsman's cudgel. The man must have thought he was dead, or the Marakander bastard would have finished him. He'd had a sword. No swords here now. There was a knife, though. He'd been lying on it. He crawled to pick it up, slow and shaky, found the sheath still in the big square pocket of his coat, and the other still heavy with coin. That was something. No Marakander guardsman, street or temple, in sight. Whatever that boiling over rage had been about, the caravaneers must have won it. It was folk of the road mobbing the house across the street. He peered blurrily. Desert folk and grasslanders, Northrons and Westrons and Nabani of the East. The woman screaming. She was Marakander, or at least she was dressed like it, in a fine embroidered caftan, and they were dragging her stumbling down the steps. Not a shop, but a fairly grand yellow plastered house that would have looked less out of place in Palace Ward or by the silver market. The porter lay limp before the door, and another, younger woman shouted, "Cowards! Traitors! Help her!" as she tried to struggle after the captive. Someone stabbed the young woman in the midriff with a spear, and she just stood staring down at it, the dark stain spreading, till they jerked it away, and she fell out of sight down the stairs, into the crowd, and a skinny man, another Marakander, staggered into the doorway, bleeding about the head. Mouth open, he slammed the door against the mob. Coward, too. Or maybe wise. Zavel watched, a bit stunned, as if it were all a dream. That wasn't a fight. That was filthy murder. In broad daylight. Murky, smoke-dulled daylight. In law-bound Marakand. The older woman kept on screaming and pleading, Let me go. I've done nothing to you. I'm no priestess. Help! Someone help! I'm a magistrate of the city, a magistrate of the suburb. You know me, old great gods, witness. You all know me. I had no part in this. I knew nothing of it. I've wronged no wizards. And then the threats. You've murdered my clerks. The lady sees, the lady knows. The voice will speak your names. You'll all die condemned in the cages for this. Outlanders or no, you're not beyond Marakand's law. Help! Help me! They dragged her away up the street, towards the city, and her cries changed again to wordless screaming. Zavel staggered to his feet to follow, uncertainly, not even sure why. Except that he didn't know what was going on, and the only way to find out was to follow. The thread of temple guard and red masks seemed past. He snagged the sleeve of a man with caravaneer's braids and stone desert tattoos.
The temple, he said. They'll come. They'd better let her. Didn't you see? The demons slew the red masks, and the ladies put to flight. What?
But the man pulled away from him, outdistancing his unsteady steps.
What demons?
Zavel called, but nobody answered. There were bodies, far more than had been mixed into the fight he'd taken part in. The streets stank like a butcher's market. Here the corpses were scattered like river-edge flotsam, in drifts and swirls among the shops and warehouses, and caravanseries just before the gore. The triangle of land between the branching roads to the riverbend and sunset gates. Zavel picked his way over men and women lying still, flies already settling in buzzing black carpets. Strange, how very still the dead, how different from the sleeping. You'd never mistake them. He wouldn't, not anymore. Folk of the road. Folk of the suburb. Temple guard. Many temple guard, in their red tunics and armor, and red masks, in crimson lacquered scale and masked helmets. But people were pulling the helmets away and dragging them into rows, and there was none of the crowing he would have expected. The exuberance of victory over the feared and hated mute priests, only a horrible solemnity. What in all the cold hells had been happening? No flies swarmed on the slain red masks. There was weeping. People were seeking their own slain. There was crying and moaning, prayer and pleading. The wounded, the dying. He ignored them, ignored the burning buildings, the shouting, the knot of fighting that broke out between Marakanders of the suburb and caravaneers. They weren't his dead, his wounded, his friends. He wasn't theirs. No one was left to claim him. If that temple guardsman had hit a bit harder, if Sarah's hand hadn't been on him, if it was on him at all, his exiled Grasslander parents had never let their Sarah Kalashi children be tattooed and claimed for the goddess of their birth. He might be one of those dead lying in the streets, and would Holasean have come looking for him, or Gagush, or any of them? Probably not. Nobody had gone to look for his mother when she walked into the dust storm. The gang dragging the magistrate took the northerly folk at the gore and then crossed the bridge over the dry ravine to Riverbend Gate, where a sizable crowd seethed and roared, beating against the timbers with what looked like the charred roof beam of a house. There were street guard on the roofs of both the squat square towers that flanked the gate, but they weren't doing anything, not worried by the improvised ram. People clawed rocks from the road and hurled them. Nobody among the attackers seemed to have a bow. What were they shouting? Murders, the devil lovers, Tamgatti. Ketsim, Tamgat's governor of Sarakalash, had escaped, fled and formed a mercenary band from the Lake Lord's surviving followers. The temple had hired them, but they'd all been sent east to deal with some barbarian tribe that menaced the city, or so Zavel had heard. Send out the lady, they cried. Give up the necromancer. Necromancer? Open the gate, a new voice roared, a red desert man gripping the magistrate by an arm. Captain, open the gate, or we kill the magistrate. The woman shrieked and tried to wrench herself away. But too many hands held her, and she was flung back and forth like a child's doll that had fallen prey to a puppy. Her ornately piled hair had come loose, spilling about her face in wild hanks. Let us in, someone shouted. And most took up the chant. Let us in! Let us in!
We want the lady! Bring out the lady! Show us your false goddess! Necromancer! Devil!
Devil? Zavel did not want to be here. Where was Holasean? Still off whoring with Tamgat's wizard? Did these fools think they could do anything against a devil, If it did come to the gate, he began to struggle away, but more than he had followed the magistrate's captors, and a crowd had closed up behind him, everyone shoving and shifting to keep their balance, trying to see, trying to hear. Many were taking up the cry of those closer to the gate, and the ones with the ram had propped the beam up like a ladder. Someone was itching up it like a cautious squirrel, though it didn't reach high enough for him to gain the arch over the gate, unless he meant to perch atop it like a bird. For a moment, attention was distracted. Soldiers in gray tunics and leather armor leaned from the parapet over the gate and shoved at the head of the beam with spears. It slid sideways with a terrible slowness at first, while the climbing man clutched it and cursed, curses changing to a shriek as it passed its tipping point and plunged. Zavel didn't see him hit, just heard the thump, the silence, the swell of roaring renewed.
"Devil's servants!" shouted the ringleader of the hostage-takers. "Let us into the necromancer, or the magistrate dies, and her blood will be on your hands."
"I'll let you in,"
an officer called down, and there was silence. He was an old man, gray-haired, weary-faced, with two black ribbons trailing from his helmet and two wide black bands on the hem of his gray tunic. A captain. He stood in a crenel of the wall, exposing himself to any missile, a hand gripping the edge of a merlin with fingers like claws, as if he really, really did not like his perch. No one threw a stone. Yet.
"You and the magistrate, no other. We'll talk about this. Open your gates, and let drunken murder loose on the folk of the city? You know I can't do that."
The captain was trying to sound reasonable, to pretend he thought the man making the demands could be reasonable.
"I don't know anything of devils, but open the gates, open the gates."
Zavel really did not want to be in the middle of this. His stomach churned, and his skin was clammy, slick with sweat. He was going to be sick, he knew it. He needed to get out of this close and reeking crowd, get some air, a drink of water. Needed to sit down somewhere quiet and let this damnable headache pass. A couple of big Northrons had axes out and were hewing at the gate, long splinters slivering away. The crowd surged forward around a woman who'd got an improvised torch alight. They piled sticks and rags and dry dead weeds to kindle a fire. The ones about the magistrate were hurling her back and forth among them as she wailed like a baby. Arms raised, clutching her head, trying to protect herself. They threw her to the ground and kicked her, took the butts of spears to her head and back as she rolled and hunched up small. The captain was gone from the crenel, and a spatter of arrows from above scattered them, left the ringleader lying dead, with others still or yelling, dragging themselves wounded. The magistrate tried to crawl, but only flopped like a landed fish. People shoved and shrieked, and the guards above kept shooting. Not a battlefield rain of arrows, but carefully, picking targets. Zavel fell, unsteady on his feet, retching again. But he crawled anyway. Safer to keep low amid the legs. Someone walked on his hand. Someone tripped on him. Someone fell and didn't move. And he half rose and scuttled, yelling with the rest. But in his dizziness, he'd gotten turned the wrong way. And he tripped over the battered magistrate. She moaned, not dead, but her face was a blood-slick pulp with only one eye, which stared wide and unseeing in its terror. Zavel yelled again and rocked away. But nobody had gone looking for his mother. Too late, they said. The sand took her. He dragged the magistrate's arm over his shoulder, shouted at her,
"Up, stand up, come on!"
Somehow he heaved her up, though she dangled limp, feet fumbling. An arrow stuck the ground at his feet, and he looked around wildly for shelter. Any shelter. A bush would do. Nothing. Shouting. Guardsmen over the gate were dumping jar after jar of water down onto the fire, which hadn't done more than stain the gate with soot, and the ram carriers had fled, though some of the mob were sheltering behind a cart abandoned on the bridge. Whatever beast had drawn it, gone. "The gate!" someone was yelling. "Old great gods, man, the gate! Now, hurry!" And it was him that she shouted at, a guardswoman up on the tower, gesturing. Zavel looked to see one leaf of the axe-scarred gate drawn back, just a hand's breadth. He didn't for a moment understand, till the magistrate moaned again. "Great gods, yes, the gate." He broke into an unsteady run, the magistrate a dead weight dragging half behind him. he caught a toe in the pit, left by upprised paving stones, and fell, both of them striking heavily, struggled up and heard voices behind him. Looked back. Shouldn't have. Blood-crazed men daring the arrows, running to overtake him. Arrows from the towers took some, gave the others pause, but a hurled javelin bit into the magistrate's thigh as he dragged her on again. And then a man was hauling her from his grasp, another grabbing him, and he himself was pulled bodily through the gate as another thrown spear thudded against its timbers. It thumped shut again, the bars dropping home. It was the gray-haired captain himself who had come out for the woman, and he swung her up like a child, running with her now, down the long arch of the gateway, turning through a dark doorway where guardsmen crowded. Zavel, with less urgency, was trundled after by other street guard. He ended up in a windowless room with a table and a couple of chairs. They dumped him on a long bench along one wall, where he sat, a bit dazed. A watch room, Zavel supposed, where the duty officer would be found, and the clerks would scratch away at recording whatever it was the Marakanders were so keen on always writing down. Yes, there were tablets and a big ledger on the table, and through another doorway, a single barred cell, the gate fort's jail, where brawlers and curfew breakers would cool their heels overnight. Not, for a change, his destination. Someone pounded him on the shoulder and said, "Good man." He clenched his teeth, which made his jaw hurt worse, and shut his eyes, holding his throbbing head. That brought a woman solicitous murmuring, and he was given a blanket, offered a cup of sweetened wine and a warm, wet towel for his wounds. Gentle, efficient hands bound up his head. It helped, at least, when he lay down afterwards, eyes shut against the glaring clay lamps in the wall niches opposite. He breathed carefully, to keep all within still and settled. A hand on his shoulder shook him awake. Zavel rubbed his eyes. However long he'd been sleeping, it hadn't been enough. A fraction of a watch, no more, maybe, but now he had a stiff back to go with his sick headache. The gray-haired captain was sitting at the table, with a clerk beside him, stylus and tablet in hand. Typical Marakanders, you couldn't tell which folk their ancestors had come from. Like their languages and their very names, picked up bits of this and that. The clerk was a pugnacious-looking bastard for a soft-handed scribe, with his crooked, flattened nose. He'd be the one to fear most if he had to bolt, Zavel was sure. A young guardswoman helped him to sit up, smiling anxiously, and pressed a cup into his hand. He smiled back. Thick, curling hair and a dark, heart-shaped face, well worth smiling at. He wasn't going to have to run. These were his friends now. The cup was coffee this time, thick and steaming. He couldn't stand the stuff, but it wasn't exactly cheap. Though even the poorest Marakanders made shift to drink it, it came all the way from beyond the Gulf of Terran and the narrow sea out of the south. "You didn't give your prisoners coffee," so he murmured his thanks and sipped it. The sweetness seemed to settle his stomach some. The captain cleared his throat.
"I'm sorry to have to tell you, young man, that Magistrate Taima has taken the road to the old great gods, Lady bless her." "I didn't."
"Of course they weren't accusing him. I didn't know her name," he amended, and added,
"I'm sorry." "Your courage is all the greater for that," the captain said earnestly, "to risk your life for a stranger."
In the darkness behind him, a shadow stirred, and Zavel realized there was another man in the room, another guardsman. The other stepped forward. Temple guard, a man with a single ribbon to his helmet and a single dark stripe on his red tunic showing below the leather skirt of his armor. An under-officer of some sort.
"Captain Hassan would like to commend you," the temple man said, "but I would like to know what other part you played in the uprising and assault on the gates."
"None," Zavel protested. I was only passing by. I saw Magistrate Taima being pulled from her house, and I followed. An old woman. I don't know what's going on. I don't know what's caused this madness in the suburb. It's nothing to do with me. But I couldn't let, it was just wrong. Beating an old woman to death that way. I waited till I saw a chance I could help her. She made me think of my mother."
The temple officer nodded.
"Naturally."
He appeared to consider something. But Zavel had grown up in market bargaining and on the road. He wasn't wet behind the ears when it came to such things. And the man had already decided whatever it was he affected to consider. Zavel's stomach clenched.
"These are sad times for our city," the temple officer said. "The lady has always looked on the folk of the road as friends of the city, and it will be a great sorrow to her that the outlanders of the suburb have been so misled by the lies of this wizard."
"Wizard?" Zavel asked, confused now. It had been demons, hadn't it, that the caravaneer had told him of?
"A Grasslander woman, or Nabani. I've heard both. A great wizard commanding demons. For a lifetime, the voice of the lady has warned of the evil wizards would bring, and it's finally come to pass. We could use a man who might know how to keep his ears open."
"Wait, this wizard, sir. You said a Grasslander or an Ebani?
You don't mean Ivah. You know of her? Is that her name?"
"I don't, probably. She's a servant of Tamgat, the lake lord, the one defeated by the goddess Adalissa last summer in Lysavakale in the mountains. I was
probably best not to claim any closer acquaintance with Adalissa. The lady was said to fear other gods, too."
Both officers fixed him in a keen stare, waiting, and the clerk scratched swiftly at his wax.
I just heard. I met her once or twice. I came here to get a report on the assault on the gates for the revered right hand of the lady," the temple man said. "But your witness could be much more useful than what Hassan here's been able to tell me."
The street guard captain frowned at this. He didn't like it. Well, if it came to a choice between street guard and temple, Zavel had a feeling the temple was the one to align himself with. Street guard was mere thief-takers, after all, and had to give way to the lady's men. Look at this one-stripe man walking all over the gate captain, and in his own fort, too. The clerk looked up, glanced at his officer, and went back to scratching.
"Captain Hassan would like to give you a pat on the back and turn you loose," the temple man went on. "I, however, think perhaps I should arrest you. You were clearly part of the assault. Perhaps you saw rescue of the unfortunate magistrate as a way of ensuring your safety, when you realized the futility of storming the lady's gates."
"I never thought at all, I just..."
"And you seem to have great knowledge of the leadership of this uprising. You know their commander's name."
"I only guess, in her inner councils, perhaps."
"That traitor? I'd cut her throat if I got close enough. If it is her at all," Zavel added hastily. "I never saw any evidence she was that great a wizard. A soothsayer, nothing more. But she was a liar, too. Probably she lied about that, and a murderer."
"However," said the temple officer, "perhaps I do believe you. I could arrest you. I should arrest you. However, if you were to volunteer to come with me, the right hand will likely take that as earnest of good intent and honest goodwill towards the lady. Any information we can put together about this wizard now is bound to be an offering the lady will approve. If you can get me next to Ivah with a saber in my hands, I'll even join your temple guard," Zavel said hotly. "I had nothing to do with whatever's going on out there. I'm an honest caravaneer." "We do need your name and gang for our records," Captain Hassan said.
"No," said the temple man decidedly. "You don't, young man."
And he came around the table, taking Zavel's arm to help him up, a bit roughly.
"That will be all, Hassan. Send your report to me, Lieutenant Surrey of the Second Company, and be sure to include how Magistrate Taima came to be murdered, with an entire company of street guard looking on."
He swept out, dragging Zavel stumbling with him. A change in his fortunes, definitely, but whether for good or ill, Zavel wasn't about to guess. If it gave him a chance at Ivah, though, and Hola was mad, was he making war on a goddess now? It looked that way, if he was one of the demons the caravaneer had been going on about. The monster inside him had corrupted his soul and broken his mind, turned him against his friends and all right thinking. A devil in the city was lies and nonsense. Tamgatti lies. Some scheme Ivah and Governor Ketsum had cooked up to turn the suburb against the goddess. Odds were Ketsum and his Tamgatti mercenaries weren't off fighting in the east after all. Odds were they were coming back up the eastern road and would be at Marakand's gates before you knew it. Ketsum and Ivah had been working closely together when they abducted Pakdala. And the lady's people would not only give him a chance to pay the lying wizard back for that and avenge his parents' deaths, but maybe even reward him if he could help them stop her. It wasn't like he had a gang to go back to. Gagush had sacked him when he had asked her for money yesterday, and in his heart of hearts, he'd known this time she meant it. Besides, he wasn't happy bedding down for the night with a possessed madman sleeping so near, out in the empty desert, Not at all. Hola's pacing and prowling in the dark was enough to give anyone the creeps. They were always telling him to grow up and take a man's place in the world. Time he did. Chapter 2. A dozen men and two women stood before her, not one daring a whisper, not one daring raise eyes to meet the gaze of their goddess. They stood close-bunched and cowed before the high pulpit, the surviving officers of the company of the Temple Guard, who had gone to the caravansary suburb with the Lady of Marakand and her red masks, her silent, invulnerable, divinely blessed and protected warrior priests. But those red masks had been proven very vulnerable indeed, to the magic of a yellow-eyed Grasslander wizard who rode into battle on a demon bear of the north with what could only be the Blackdog of Lysavakale, a tide of death before her. That was neither here nor there. These had proven coward, all the Temple Guard had, faithless betrayers who broke and ran when they found the shield of the red masks did not protect them. They had failed their oaths, failed their faith, failed her, their goddess, when they found that the folk of the suburb, who ought to have been cowering unmanned and witless before the divine terror of her servants, were willing and able to fight. They had thought they went at no risk to themselves to arrest wizards made impotent and witless by the divine blessing of those same red masks, to take for the lady's well even the least of the diviners who had thought themselves safe and outside the lady's ban and reach, beyond Marakand's city walls. They were used to such easy tasks, secure in the shadow of the lady's greater servants. That the folk had lost their terror of the red masks, no, that the divine blessing of terror had been stripped from them by inexplicable wizardry, did not excuse the cowardice of the temple guards. To fail and flee because you found the enemy capable of fighting back was the mark of a bully, not a soldier. Zora had told them so. No captain stood among them. He was dead, killed by caravaneers, outlanders. He had not been standing, no, that she had seen. He had died running, knocked down from behind, hacked and pummeled to death in the dust. A fitting end for a coward. The company's senior lieutenant, nearly unable to stand, one eye bloodied, cheek open and not yet stitched, had done no better, except that he had lived to make it to the gate. As had she. She had fled with the rest of them. That was different. That was a sensible tactic. She had needed to remove her red masks from danger. Without them, the city might fall. Without them, she might fail. And what followed her failure? She had been right to run, to take her damaged red masks out of reach of the wizard and her demons. Yes, she had brought them back to the temple, even the one stationed at the eastern wall to watch for Praetanic enemies, and the one at the western. Did she dare leave the eastern wall unwatched by eyes she trusted? The first whisper of this, the first stir and swirl of a changing current, had not come from within the city. There had been a spy. Spies? The first red mask to die had died there. She had nearly forgotten. She had not been Zora then. Doubt would cripple her. She had enemies all about her, and she did not even know who they might be. She had sent her captain and his red masks, all who were not now in the city, east to Praetan. But death came from the west, from the north, not east. North? No. The Sword of the Ice, she had muttered that aloud. She heard the words. Zora pinched her lips together. A small sound escaped the huddled guards. One of the women, stifling a whimper. Weak. Other than the senior lieutenant, they were all patrol firsts, the leaders of the five-man units modeled on the patrols of the street guard. Leaders of their patrols. Examples to their men. These were the ones who had swept with their goddess through the Riverbend Gate. Retreated. Fled. And some part of Zora's heart crowed, a part that might still be Zora. Fool child. I am, we are Zora, as we are the Lady of Marakand. The Lady, their goddess, surveyed them. Not vengeful. Not disdainful. Sorrowful, yes, pitying their weakness, their frailty. No. The Lady could not harbor the weak and the frail. Marakand must be strong. He would come against her, out of the west, and Marakand must be strong. Yes. The Lady sees your hearts, she said from the pulpit, and the 14 huddling together on the swirling mosaic floor on which she had so often danced when she was only Zora, when she was only the foremost of the temple dancers, when she was the hidden eyes, the spy of her father's stillborn rebellion against the tyranny of the lady. They watched her, as the hypnotized bird watches the snake. They had hope. The lady was mercy.
Who says so? The lady. Fools if you believe her.
Hush. Behind them, the priests and priestesses, saffron-robed, clustered. Fear was a rank cloud over them. Red masks had died. The caravansary suburb had risen against the lady's arrest of wizards. The gates were under attack. Enemies, treachery, hidden wizards, disorder. They liked their safe order, her priests. She had taught them so.
Never, she said, has Marakand faced such danger as it does now. Rebels walk secretly among the folk of the suburb, of the city itself, spreading the poison of their lies. Foreign wizards and demons work against us. And what strength have we? Not the strength of arms, if the faith of those arms is weak. Weakness betrays us. Weakness has betrayed us. When the temple guard should have stood firm to protect their comrades in arms, my chosen, my red masks, from appalling wizardry, from foreign demons and spirits, and the servants of alien gods, they fled, squalling like children and about as much use. Unfair, she had fled, had she not? She must give them an explanation for that, a reason, an enemy, a plan, not her own fear, her death in. The sword, the ice is coming, the road of the stars is sealed against the ice is coming. Zora's hands clutched the pulpit rail, and she licked her lips. She was not the voice, the mad voice, to spill the eddying mind of the goddess. She was not mad. Mad Sign Moore was dead and burnt away. She was Zora now. Zora was not mad. Zora had not spoken aloud. The words echoed only in her mind. She did not taste them on her tongue. She would not. She could not. She... Be still, be still, be still. The lady sees your hearts, she said. The lady knows your hearts. Your coward hearts. Your traitor hearts. And I say, treachery must be cut out. There is no place for such weakness and cowardice within my temple. When I say stand, you stand. When I say hold, you hold. You do not doubt. You do not break. You do not run. You stand and hold and die, if that is what serves your lady's need. As it would have this day, had you not been faithless.
No, 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 don't. I won't. I can't. I must. She had no need for orders, for gestures. The red masks were hers, as her arms and legs were hers. The most faithful of her priests, so even the true priests believed, the holy warriors, with their vows of simplicity and silence, their isolated barracks where not a single servant attended them. Fools. Even Zora, spying for the dead, had not penetrated to the heart of that secret. Though she had wondered, she had known there was some truth that she could not see. A poor, lorn spy without a master to take her reports. Still, for the sake of the priests, she raised a hand. It might have been a signal, but it was her thought that sent her attendant, red masks, grim in their silence, faceless, to the unfortunate officers. No need for their swords, for mess and blood, and the fouling of the black and white floor on which she had danced. Like the street guard, the thief-takers, her red masks carried short staves at their belts. The white lightings of her will, their wizardry, crackled as they struck. A blow to the back of the head, to the chest, a smashed face as the already bloodied lieutenant turned yelling to flee. A single blow was enough to kill. The room smelt of scorching, of burnt meat. Sacrifice. The remainder of the company, she said, when it was done, when a fainting priestess had been shunted aside amid her fellow's feet, and a vomiting priest had made it as far as the porch before disgracing himself and her holy hall of the dome. Will be confined to their barracks. No surgeon will attend the wounded. Let them look to themselves. Let the old great gods choose their own. They will have barely porridge and water and nothing more. They will purify themselves. Let them offer me prayers and face the truth of their own hearts for 3 days. In 3 days they will be summoned here to the hall of the dome to stand before their lady. And she will, I will, give my judgment. They would be redeemed and love her for her forgiveness, their redemption. She would appoint new patrol firsts, a new captain and pair of lieutenants. She could not afford to lose so many men. But they did not need to know that.
Revered lady.
It was Ahjvar who dared to speak, the right hand of the lady, highest ranking of the priests, a bald and bitter man, loving her, hating her. The beholder of the face, his wife, had died by her command, flung down the stairs to the underground chamber of the deep well. Yet he still loved his lady, and he still served, but she did not love him. No, she said, to whatever it was. I will not hear. I will speak no more. I will speak no more judgments today. I will just go, out, all of you, out from this place, out from here, out with your noise and your doubts and your coward fears, out and pray yourselves, and pray I am merciful, because I know not all the traitors of the city are without the temple walls. Her voice rose to a shriek in her own ears, and her hands twisted together. The sword waits still, can't you see? Don't you hear me? The sword is ice, the ice is death, and from the north it came to me, for me, not here, not now, does she not see? Does she not know? I have trapped her, held her, she would have betrayed me, she should have seen, she should have known, she should have come to me to stand with me. It is he, it is not I, she should fear. We should fear she is nothing, she is gone, she is lost. And trapped and gone, and still the sword waits, unsleeping, it sees my dreams, it whispers, it sings, the voice of the wind, of the ice, of the night. The stars, the cold and distant stars they see. She bit her tongue, the taste of blood shocked and silenced her. The priests stared. They were used to the ranting prophecies of the voice of the lady, but she was not the voice. She was the lady made flesh, in the flesh of Zora, the dancer they would have given to be her new voice. She was, I don't know anymore. Who am I who speaks? Get out, she screamed, and the red masks moved. The priests and priestesses fled. The red masks began dragging out the bodies. Let the priests see to some burial, somehow. Let them prove their use by dealing with that one small problem, with the city gates sealed, and no access to the graveyard of the Gore. Zora was going to be vomiting behind a pillar herself if she could not get out of here, into air. Clean air, and space, and sky, and up, climb, yes, to where she could breathe again. The goddess, the Lady of Marakand incarnate, took the stairs so rarely used, cramped and dark, hidden with the walls, the passage left for workmen who might need sometimes to make repairs. She ran, forcing herself not to slow, reveling in the pounding of her soldier-booted feet, her racing heart. This was hers. This body, this strength, this lean beauty, this was she. She came out on the roof below the dome. There, for a moment at least, she had silence, even in her own mind, though not for long. Chapter 3.
My wife, the old man at the gate howled. Gate captain, look, witness, my wife.
But what the old man held in his arms, staggering with the weight of it, arms and legs and long hair dangling limp, was the red armored corpse of a red mask. Jugurthos Baria, captain of the Sunset Gate Fort, looked down from the northerly of his towers. He didn't know the man, some small trader of the suburb, by his dress. He was surrounded, supported maybe, by a score or so of others, Marakanders and Caravaneers both. Even from the tower, Jugurthos couldn't see what was happening around the bend of the wall, to the north, but he had seen a band of temple guard in red masks rushing disordered to the east. And after them, pursuing, a surge of outlanders armed out of the smoking suburb. Pursuing, red masks fleeing. He'd sent a courier to Hassan at Riverbend Gate for news, but the girl hadn't returned yet. Nothing worse had befallen than that she was waiting on Hassan, he hoped, and not caught up in some assault. The all-in curfew had rung from Riverbend shortly after that, and his own bells had perforce passed it on. It shouldn't have kept his courier, though. If what had rushed east along the main road, past the Gore, had been an attack, this small party that had peeled off to take the road to the southern bridge and his gate seemed peaceable enough thus far. Grim, though, and angry. Violence only a word away. Not that the bare score below could offer the gates any serious threat.
Witness, the man called again. Witness what?
Jugurthos called down. A red mask? A dead red mask, and they were invulnerable, protected from weapon and wizardry by the lady's blessing. they killed with a touch. What could touch them? That, indeed, needed witnessing. If it were true, and not some trickery, a corpse wrapped in a red cloak, yet that armor would be hard to come by, and there was a story going around that a red mask had died at the eastern wall, not long before the voice was killed. He had dismissed it as exaggeration, some mere temple guard murdered, even though he had heard it from Captain Hassan of Riverbend, who swore he had the story from his cousin, who saw the corpse from some distance before another red mask carried the priest away.
What killed her? How?
My wife, the man howled, and he laid the corpse down, kneeling over it, and stroked a dead, smooth cheek with his old, twisted hand. Jugurthos felt his stomach turn, surely.
Don't you dare,
his adjutant muttered beside him.
Captain, don't.
He looked down at her. Tulip only came up to his shoulder, a compact woman, young for her responsibilities, with the round face and straight hair of the mountain folk. She hadn't even been a patrol first when he appointed her as adjutant, and given her physique, which was rather better filled out in all the right places than you'd expect of an unwanted bastard abandoned and farmed out on temple charity. Everyone was fairly certain they knew why. Useful to let them think so, of course. That, on the other hand, she was his mistress, was just a further obscuration. Yeah, right, she would say. You really know how to make a girl feel wanted, Captain. Jugurthos pushed away from the parapet.
I'm coming down,
he called to the old man and strode for the stairs. Tulip, muttering imprecations, scurried after him. A patrol was just coming in. She drafted them as escort, grabbed a spear from his office, one of the few weapons not locked in the armory, and glowered to the point that Jugurthos swallowed any protest. There was no sally port in either gate tower. They had to haul back a leaf of the main gates enough for the seven of them to slip out. Two by wary two, with Jugurthos, giving in to Tulip's common sense, in the middle. None of the mob beyond moved towards them, parting, rather, and standing back to give them passage. The old man had gathered the red mask into his arms again, held her on his lap, head lolling against his shoulder. He glared at them through tears, said nothing now, but stroked the hair from her face. A woman in her prime, which the old man was definitely not, dark-haired. Jugurthos had seen corpses enough, victims of family quarrels and drunken brawls, sullen, stealthy murders, and alley robberies. This was different. Old. Her skin was dry and tinged with gray, the staring eyes cloudy, the lips shriveled, colorless. No stink of death, though, and not the greasy, horrid rot of that infant's corpse unearthed from a rubbish heap by stray dogs last winter. He swallowed against that memory, and warily crouched to put a hand to the face himself. Dry, neither warm nor cold, like touching wood, cloth. The old man blinked at him.
Your wife,
he prompted, and fingered the slick lacquered leather of the armor scales, the crimson cloak, which up close was tattered, faded, and unexpectedly gritty to the touch, as if it had never been washed or even brushed clean.
They took her,
the old man said.
The week after they built that tomb for Ilbialla and butchered her priestess. You wouldn't remember, you're too young. You think there was always a tomb there in Sunset Market, but... I remember,
Jugurthos said. He was hardly so young as all that. Tulip put a warning hand on his shoulder.
Go on, who took her? Red masks. They came. I worked with my brother in those days, and we lived up above his shop at the back. Sandalmakers, he and I. Alinea read the coins, the Nabani divination, but it didn't bring in much, more just as a favor for neighbors, you know. And half the time nothing came to her, and she just told them what she thought they wanted. Joking, almost, between friends. They came, red masks, and they took her as a wizard. We used to pray for children. We'd been childless so long. I've never prayed since, save to thank Ilbialla we had none. I wouldn't stay in the city after that. I moved out to the suburb.
And all the while, he never left off stroking her hair.
But the red masks take wizards for execution by the temple, Jugurthos said. Condemned to death in the deep well, by the voice's decree. They're priests, not,
he swallowed.
She can't be your wife. She's some priestess. She's not 30 yet, this woman.
Stupid thing to say. Stupid. The old man was manifestly not deluded. His eyes, though swimming with tears, burned. No confusion there.
She died that day,
or not long after, the sandalmaker said. She hasn't changed, hasn't, she hasn't.
He wailed and bowed his head over her.
They said, when they killed her out there, now they said, the temple, a necromancer, a devil, one of the seven.
The words came out as half-strangled gasps through sobs.
A devil? All right, Jugurtho said inanely. All right.
He put a hand on the man's shoulder.
All right, just tell me. What about necromancy and a devil? Who, no. To start with, what's your name?
Ergos, the man said.
Ergos Eric.
A very distant connection to the Eric Nuriel family, then.
How did she die, this time?
Jugurthos amended.
What happened out there, when the lady came?
Bring him inside, said Tulip in his ear. He nodded, recalled the sense.
Yes, inside.
Kneeling on the road before his gates with a riot or worse in the suburb was folly. But the men and women who had followed Ergos Eric to the gate stood watching, menacing in their silence, and now murmured, hands, some of them, on weapons.
I'm not arresting him, he said loudly. I'm not going to make him disappear.
Or let him disappear, if temple guards came for him. If red masks came, what choice would he have?
Cold hells, fine then. I do,
he grinned, a hand on his sword's hilt to stress that it wasn't their threat he bowed to. A couple of the Marakanders stepped back. No backing off on the part of the caravaneers, though.
See your point. We'll all stay out here in the open. To witness. Tulip, go back. I want a Tullian out here to set down everything that's said. And Bellman, too.
Bellman was the senior-most patrol officer. He didn't have to say.
Bellman and her patrol, as well as the clerk, and maybe a double patrol while you're at it, to make sure we can make it back to the gate afterwards.
Not to Tulip. She nodded understanding and strode away.
Wait till my clerk comes,
he told the old man.
Calm yourself. Get your words in order. We'll set them down fair. You wanted witness. You'll have witness. Testimony is set down clear and true before the gods and the old great gods.
And in the plural, he betrayed himself, yes? The gods alone might have passed, been taken for the old great gods. Old Ergos didn't notice, but at his side, a sharp-faced girl's eyes narrowed. Ergos laid the woman down again, folded her hands above her breast, and tried unsuccessfully to close the clouded eyes. The patrol hovered too close, their attention more on the corpse than the onlookers or the road. They whispered together. Jugurthos snapped at them to keep an eye to the bridge, and Tulip returned, with the clerk and three patrols, one of which, at a jerk of Bellman's head, hung back at the gate. The onlookers gave a little ground, but muttered. Tulip's face was grim, and she crouched to whisper in his ear again. Couriers back from Hassan. The ladies fled to the temple in disorder, the riverbend gates being attacked by caravaneers. Nothing Hassan can't handle.
Fled?
Jugurthos said aloud, checking his own bridge yet again and the footpath that hugged the wall. Nothing stirred there, no trouble spilling around from the north. The suburb itself, though smoke rose, seemed quiet.
Don't speak to them, said a woman suddenly. You were a damned fool to give your name, Master Ergos. We shouldn't have come here. They'll use your words against you. Come away while you still can.
The girl, the one with a face like a curious weasel, said, No, you were right, Uncle. The city needs to witness, if we all die for it. Tell the captain. But the old man was listening to neither, his eyes fixed on Jugurthos again.
Tell me, Jugurthos said. Itulian set his testimony down.
Because that was the law, wasn't it? An accusation needed to be recorded, witnessed, brought to a magistrate. There were a score of auditors here from the suburb, and as many street guard, and he felt he was balanced on a bridge like a sword's edge. And the crossing. He would fall. They all would. Disappear into the depths of the lady's well. Red masks would come for the record, for those who dared accuse and those who might have listened. But that was a red mask, vulnerable and dead. Long dead if the old sandalmaker were to be believed. And Jugurthos would stake, was staking, his life the old man spoke honest truth. A bridge like a sword's edge, and if crossed, if he dared, run and don't look down.
The lady rode to the suburb with the company of red masks and temple guard,
Jugurthos prompted.
What then? They came for wizards,
Ergo said.
There's always a few wizards among the caravaneers. There is diviners and such in the suburb. A few, in secret. But they killed. The temple guards started it.
They killed honest tradesfolk for no reason. And the lady looking on and the accused wizards and the red masks took them. And if their friends and kin tried to save them, they died and then the wizard came.
What wizard?
Jugurthos asked. Etulian's bronze stylus jabbed and flicked over the wax.
I don't know, Outlander, Caravaneer. Someone said she was Grasslander, but she looked Nabani to me.
A Grasslander who looked Nabani, a Nabani who looked Grasslander. One face came to mind at once. Old great gods, if the black-haired Grasslander Ivah, Hadidu's lodger, were not dead, then no one had ever escaped. Once taken by red masks, and Ivah and Nor, both wizards, had been taken, staying behind to let Hadidu get his child, and the young servants away, when temple guard and red masks burnt the doves to the ground.
What's this wizard's name? I don't know, a great wizard, sent to us by the old great gods, maybe. She came out of nowhere, riding a bear. What? A bear, a great demon bear, golden, a servant of the gods, and a giant dog like a nightmare of a dog, black as night, with them. And when they struck red masks, they fell. She broke the terror of the red masks, Ergo said, and gripped his wrist. Captain, the wizard, she did that. Suddenly, we were afraid, all of us afraid, but it was our own honest fear and we could stand. We could think. We could fight the temple guard. We could dare. We could stand against the temple then, and the lady saw it and fled back into the city. And we, and people thought, they stripped the red masks, and they weren't. They weren't. We thought they were priests and soldiers, and they were dead.
Old dead, said the sharp-faced girl, with a look at Etulian. Not dead of the bear and the dog and the wizard. Set that down. My mother's aunt, since you're setting it all down for our deaths. I never knew her. She was arrested and executed before I was born. But he knows her. My uncle, my master. Don't you dare look him in the face and deny it.
I'm not, said Jugurthos. The wizard said the lady was dead, the true lady, and a devil had taken her place, said Ergos.
But someone at the back contradicted.
No, she said the lady was a devil and a necromancer.
And someone else said, there was a devil in Lysavakhel, and the goddess of the lake drove him out, and he's come here. Argument followed among caravan folk as to whether that devil had been slain or driven away. The clerk Etulian gave Jugurthos a harried look. He made a dismissive gesture. Enough. It was enough.
The red masks are no priests,
the old sandermaker shrieked, jerking to his feet, hands fisted.
They're dead. The enslaved dead. The violated dead. And the Lady of Marakand's the necromancer. I accuse her. I'll swear it to any magistrate. I'll cry it in the streets. I'll cry it from the voice's own pulpit, from Ilbialla's tomb. The lady is a devil, and this is the proof if I die for it. This was my wife.
His supporters surged up around him, shoving, and the patrol reached for their clubs. Tulip's knuckles whitened on her spear, but she only held it sideways, putting herself between Jugurthos and the throng.
Will you come into the city?
Jugurthos said.
Captain,
said Tulip in apprehension.
Uncle, the niece apprentice cried.
Bring her into the city, to the market square.
Jew, Tulip hissed. He was running the sword's edge, and dizzy with it, and it might not even reach to the far bank of the chasm beneath.
To the tomb of Ilbialla, he said.
Where better? The old man took a deep and shaking breath.
And what will that do? I don't know. Let's find out. Bellman, bring the sandalmaker's wife, the diviner, with due respect.
Etulian, I want. Jugurthos made hasty calculations.
10 fair copies of that testimony made at once. Draft every literate guardsman you need and dictate it. But 10 at the very least. We don't. Find them. Send someone to roust out a few scribes, then folk who live near. Merchants' clerks from the warehouses. Go. Don't waste time.
Time would run through his hands. A lifetime waiting for what he had thought would never come. A vague someday. The lady fled to the temple. The red masks, maybe not impotent, but proven vulnerable, proven, an abomination and a testimony against the temple, against the lady. Patrol First Bellman and 3 others used the red mask's own cloak to wrap and lift her, and the old sandal maker let them, watching, with his niece, great niece, standing arm about his waist, chewing her lip.
Don't trust them, a tattooed black desert caravaneer urged. They'll hand you over to the temple. They'll bury the truth.
The Riverbend gates being attacked by the suburb, Jugurtho said. They know all this?
A hand spread towards the body.
We all know the truth now. The city doesn't. The city's not your enemy. It's as much a victim of the voice, the lady, whoever and whatever this necromancer is, as you. It's been as afraid as you, more so. You can leave, Caravan Man. We live here with the red masks walking our streets.
Not that they did so all so often, but there was always the one day they would come, and their terror would leave you helpless, broken, and shaking as a beaten child.
We all need to know this truth.
And then, Tulip muttered, old great gods, Chew, what follows then? Riverbend's under attack, and it'll be a massacre if a horde of caravaneers out for revenge gets through.
Law, said Jugurthos. Law, the street guard, and the Senate. We're Marakand, not the temple. The suburb needs to remember that. Come inside, all you here. In, to witness, as you said. And then leave. Leave freely, and rein in whatever madness for revenge is still brewing out there.
He jerked a hand at the smoke-shrouded buildings beyond the gore.
You all came here with Urgos Eric. You didn't go to Riverbend raging for blood.
Some of that crowd would have torn her to pieces, dead as she was, sniffed the niece. So we turned off. These just followed. The Senate, remarked Tulip to the sky, is more or less appointed by the beholder of the face of the lady.
Oh, said Jugurthos. I meant the other Senate.
There isn't another Senate.
No, but I think, since the red masks appear to have enemies who can destroy them at last, there will be.
A curt order, and his patrols headed back to the gate, shepherding the sandalmaker and his niece with them. About 2/3 of the suburb folk followed, more than Jugurthos expected.
The law against bearing weapons in the city streets is not in abeyance, he said,
as the gate shut behind them.
But,
as there was a growl from some of the caravaneers,
under these circumstances, for this one time only, you can consider yourselves requested to assist the street guard in protecting Master Urgos.
Aside to Tulip, he added,
get the damned armory unlocked and arm the patrols. Tell them right off. There's a devil ruling the temple in the lady's name. Tell them. They're sworn to protect the city and see the laws kept. The city's law, not the temple's. But any you decide you can't trust, don't arm.
He named a few names. Tulip added several more.
And then, take a messenger's baton in case you're stopped and get to the apothecaries. Tell Hedidu I need him here. I need him to speak to the people.
Are you serious?
All or nothing. The last rush, the last leap to the far lip of the chasm, the sword bridge falling away beneath him.
Yes.
Captain, said the old man. Captain, what's your name?
Jugurthos, he said.
Baria, son of Senator Petromos Baria and Senator Elias.
Urgos was more than old enough to remember those names. He breathed out a long, ah, and nodded, something understood. Stood a little straighter, took his great niece's arm, rather than leaning on her.
Look, girl, he said. Here's the true head of family Baria. He's no temple puppet. We're all right.
We're all dead together.
We're going to carry your wife to the market, said Jugurthos. The priest of Ilbialla.
Priest? A priest of Ilbialla? Are the gods returned?
No, said Jugurthos. But that doesn't mean Marakand can't keep faith with them. The priest will come to give your wife a blessing for the road at Ilbialla's tomb.
Not that the poor empty corpse was likely to have any ghost yet clinging to it.
Etulian, he called back over his shoulder. Get those copies made, now. And at the end, come now to the Sunset Gate Market. Witness for yourselves. Hear what must be said, in the name of the true gods of Marakand. I'll see to their sealing myself.
With his mother's seal, which he'd managed to hold onto through everything. Testimony for some few of the gate and ward captains, he was almost certain of. For particular senators and magistrates, he thought, maybe he could move. For certain elderly men and women, powerful in the families, who were not high in the temple's favor, who had lived quiet and retired long years now. And then, what followed. Ilbialla and Gurhan and the true lady, if there had ever been a true lady, be with them all.
Chapter 4. Her thoughts were filled with voices, and all of them were hers. Zora, who was a temple dancer, to Usha, who was one of the seven devils of the stories of the North, who had once walked among the stars. The lady, who was the goddess of the deep well of Marakand, betrayed by Taousha.
Sign more.
No, not sign more. Taousha had been bound as one with sign more, conjoined souls, but the wizard of the southern ocean was dead. She must be dead. She had burned. She, sign more, was she Zora now. But the thoughts yammered and piled upon her, a great tsunami to drown and crush and batter. And that was sign more's thought. She, Zora, knew nothing of oceans, had never seen a lake, never even seen water flow in the dry river, the ravine that crooked like a bent arm to embrace Marakand. The most water she had ever known was in the temple baths. But in her mind, she saw a great wave, and she stood on a high hill and heard the gulls and the cries, and these thoughts that were hers and not yet hers. Who was she who thought them, heard them? They drowned her. Fool and coward girl, she had fled the battle. No, she had retreated. That was common sense. She was no blood-mad Northron berserker to stand to death, believing glory and songs better than the achievement of one's long aim. She had withdrawn from the suburb. She would return, and it would burn. Not yet. No, not yet. The better part of her strength, the lady's strength, her red masks, lay far away. She still drew on them, as all were one, one web of power, and she at its heart, sustained and sustaining. But they were not here. She must await their coming. On her orders, the bells had rung from gate tower to ward blockhouse, all over the city. The jangling peals of the all-in curfew, not briefly, as at sunset when the city gates were closed, but a long, unceasing peal, warning the folk to get themselves within doors, to clear the streets or face arrest, warning the captains of the city gates to close them, to seal the city against enemies within or without. Both, maybe. No warlord great enough to get his army past the western wall at the distant end of the pass had arisen in the four deserts in living memory. It was nearly 20 years since so much as a raider band had swept up to threaten the suburb, though the wall had now fallen mostly into ruin. The lady taxed the caravan road to repair it. The work had been ongoing for years. The enemy at the city's gates now had not passed in by the western or the eastern walls, except in the ordinary way of trade. They were caravaneers of the road, merchants' folk, even trader folk of Marakand, who had their homes and shops in the suburb. They were her enemies, Marakand's enemies. She was the Lady of Marakand. Her name was Zora. Be calm, breathe slowly, let peace and stillness rise. The white silk of scarves and surcoat flattened to her and streamed aside, stained dark. She stank, but she made a beautiful image. She knew, her slender figure straight and strong. Her cascading dark hair came loose and blowing like a banner, the white silk rippling in the rising wind, and the blood against the white, the red lacquered armor beneath, reminded those who might look up, huddled whispering clusters of priests, small mounds of yellow robe, from here, that she had fought for them, fought for their city. The long shadows of the westering sun framed her. She gleamed in the golden light of the dying day. Their goddess no longer hid, timid and shy, withdrawn in her well, speaking through a mad priestess. I am my own mad priestess now. They had seen how she rode ahead of them. She fought for Marakand. Marakand was hers to fight for. Beneath her, Zora could see the temple enclave, a depression below the level of the city, like the footprint of a giant's horse, circled with cliff and wall. The gatehouse, where the only entrance from the city plunged down a tunnel cut through the rock. To the north was the ravine, the dry riverbed, the temple wall there, ancient walls and buildings, was city wall. That was how the assassin who had slain the voice of the lady had doomed her, damned her, doomed and damned Zora, had found his way into the temple, through a forgotten and abandoned door, high on the wall, where once had been a landing for boats, when there had been boats, when there had been a river. Some of her red masks had returned to her by that door, and they guarded it now. But that was not enough. The wizard and the bear demon and the dog, who was not a demon, but she did not want to think what he might be, what he must not be, could not be. Not him, not here, not, of course he was not. Her brother would never so demean himself as to take the body of a dog. Zora had no brother. Hush, hush, hush. Be still. They might come that way. They would kill more red masks if they did. So few were left to her. She would be starved of human wizardry if they attacked again. She had sent too many of her servants east with the captain of her red masks, her beautiful golden captain, whom she would make High King of Prayton in the lady's name, once Prayton was restored to Marakand. She could not risk the few who remained to her against the Grasslander wizard and her demon and the dog. Not now. Not until her captain returned. She could not risk the loss of any more nodes in the web of her wizardry, which was not hers. Neither Zora nor Bodiless Teusha nor the Lady of Marakand were wizards as Sine Moore had been. The wellsprings of human wizardry no longer lay within her, for all the wizard's knowledge she possessed. She had made the red masks to be not her wizards, but her wizardry, to restore what was lost with Sine Moore's death. So, she must wait. She must hold here until her captain returned. He was Red Mask, but he was a great wizard and swordsman. She would set him against the Grasslander. She would set him against the demon of the earth, the bear. She would set him even against the dog, whatever it truly was. And then she would have many Red Masks, the wizards of Prayton over Malagru, and the wealth of Prayton would be the seed of an empire. And Marakand would be strong. Marakand would be great. And it would be her fortress against what she knew gathered in the west. She had only to hold, to wait. Zora narrowed her eyes. Wait until the wizard great enough to break even her spells, woven of human wizardry, strong with many silenced voices, rode the demon to her very gates. Wait till the, call him monster, spirit, creature of the mountains, call him anything but what he must not be, could not be, was not, surely was not. He is a devil, and you and I do not know his name. No, never. No. Wait till the dog came to try his strength against hers. No, he was some creature of the mountain goddess. No devil, not possible.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.